Hello, everyone. So, as you might have guessed, I work for this company, which, as Garrett at the start, I also have to show you the slide that basically says, no matter what I lie to you, don't make any purchase decisions, or otherwise Oracle wouldn't be liable for whatever you do. So it's actually a very relieving slide, because it really means that I can tell you anything about anything, and I'm still not liable for whatever you do with that information. So my name is Attila. I'm in Oracle's Java Lang Tools group. We are responsible for the Java compiler, various toolings around it, a bit of core libraries, and among other things, also Nashorn, which is the JavaScript runtime in the JVM. Before joining Oracle, I spent 2 years being the resident JVM tuning expert at Twitter in San Francisco. This actually happened pretty accidentally. Turned out that when I joined, I was the only one who actually knew how to tune GC at Twitter. So they just pretty much locked me in a room for 2 years and was bringing me badly tuned programs to fix. So no wonder I left them. So Nashorn is an ECMAScript 5.1 runtime on top of the JDK. It's open source. It's developed as part of the OpenJDK. It's very simple to use. It has its own. It doesn't really have its own API. You just use the Java ECMAScript APIs, which are present in the Nashorn ever since Java 6. It does have its own API, but you only need to use it for some customizations. We will actually see some of that. It runs from command line with JJS, which is the Java launcher for JavaScript, probably contender for one of the worst named utilities. It doesn't have an interpreter. It compiles to Java bytecode on the fly. And what I will not be talking about in this talk is why would you want to use JavaScript on the JVM? OK, I will, but only a little bit. People often ask me, why would you use JavaScript on the JVM? So often, if you yourself develop a system, you might be writing a platform and having a separate set of people actually writing applications on top of it. So as a customization platform, it's really great for that. Quite often, you might have some algorithm that's implemented in JavaScript and you want to integrate it into your system. Or you just want to write a JavaScript system to begin with, and you would like to deploy it on a JVM with its industry strength, 20 years proven garbage collection, threading, libraries, and so on. So those are all valid reasons. I also will not talking to you about how to use Java-specific features from JavaScript. Everything can be used. You can subclass Java, classes from JavaScript. You can pass functions as lambdas. You can just manipulate the POJOs with the same syntax as you would. Otherwise, there's a lot of talks about this. This is not what this talk is about. This talk is about performance mostly, which is it's actually pretty interesting how we get to performance here. I will tell you a lot about what is it that we, on our side, do to make Nashorn run fast. And I will talk about what would you need to do if you were to integrate Nashorn in your Java-based system to make sure that it runs fast. And obviously, this talk, sometimes I think about it, is you might even say that this talk is a bit of a trap for myself, because it really shouldn't exist. If I am responsible for the Nashorn engine, well, I'm not, because I'm not working on it alone, but if me and my teammates are responsible for Nashorn, the engine, why am I talking about how to make it fast? Why don't I just go and then make it fast, right? So we did a lot to make Nashorn actually run fast. What you see on this slide is everything we did since the initial release in Java 8. Since initial release in Java 8, we did things like parameter type specialized compilation of functions. I'll explain what that is. Static type inference for local variables. Because we compile to bytecode, we actually need to compile to most efficient representation. Bytecode is statically typed. It uses ints, longs, doubles, and so on. We do optimistic typing with gradual deoptimizing compilation. And we use that when we cannot statically prove a type of a local variable or any variable, then we need to do a guess. And what we do is that we are always guessing that it will be an int, and then we have to have a fallback for when we are wrong. So if we did all of that, so what's left then? Oh, tons. So I could probably retire from Oracle in 20 years' time and still not implement all the possible optimizations for JavaScript, because the languages are so damn dynamic that every possible optimization on the earth can be applied at some time. We still have a lot to do that we haven't touched. On the other hand, if you integrate it into your Java-based system, there are some things that you need to pay attention to how do you integrate it. And you also need to pay attention to not make things too hard for the runtime to reason about. These are two separate topics that we'll get to. So, existing features. First, I want to show you how we do type specialized compilation. Type specialized compilation basically means that if you have this function that squares its parameter, and you invoke it twice, one with an int and one with a double, once with a double, Nashorn will actually compile two versions of that code, one that takes an int and one that takes a double. And at the requisite points, it will actually invoke those. I can actually demonstrate this really quickly here. I have this program, square.js, which, as you can see, is pretty much the same thing. If you just run it, it is very non-charismatic, right? We can make it a little bit more interesting if we do dash pc, which is for print code, and then Nashorn will just spill all the bytecode that it generates as it runs. So if I do try to find the code for try to find the code for it, you can see that the first version that's compiled actually does take an int and returns an int. It loads its arguments as ints, multiplies them, and returns the result as an int. And then it eventually prints the result. What's funny is that after that, it will generate the code for the double version, and after that's done, plus some other stuff, you eventually get the other result printed. So it means that Nashorn actually only generates the code for a function with a specified type when, it first encounters an invocation for that type. So we are very lazy. We only generate code when we absolutely cannot avoid not to. If we could run your program without ever generating code, I swear we'd do it. But still in the future, plenty of years until I retire. Static type inference, how does that work? This is, we use Google's Octane benchmark that they use for V8 benchmarking. We use it both for testing correctness and also for testing performance. And this is the hot loop. This is the function that's the hot loop in the crypto benchmark. It's doing all kinds of, as you would expect, cryptographic number shifting. And Nashorn, if you just invoke it and let it run on this and let it inference the types of the local variables, if it has to be conservative, then it doesn't really look so good because you have those trouble spots. Like if you decrement an argument, n, that comes in as an int, we actually have to assume that it will be double. Actually, we would have to assume that it's long, but we currently assume double. Long story. Because it can overflow, obviously. That poor l down there, we actually have to treat it as an object. Why? Because we do a retrieval from that array there, the w array j, and in JavaScript, you can't know what will you get back. You might get back a string, in which case the plus operator will be concatenation. So. The point is, we cannot know statically that this will not happen. Similarly, C down there, since there's a multiplication at the end, we have to presume that even though we are multiplying two ints, they might overflow, so again, it has to be a double. So, almost looks good, but still not that good. As you can see, the first assignment to L is actually int, the one that's not marked, that's immediately below while, because there we're actually retrieving something but doing a bitwise operator, and we know that in JavaScript bitwise operator we always return an int. However, if we combine this with our optimistic typing feature, then the picture is much clearer. Everything that was trouble spots disappears, we will presume that everything is an int. To quote Lego the movie, everything is awesome. Of course, the question is, what happens when something is not that awesome? We'll get to that. So, this actually allows a very synergistic code generation. And, you know, it's like, see, I put synergy on a slide and I lose three people in the audience. But that's because their marketing people have totally corrupted this term. Synergy actually means when several different effects are combined for something that's more than the sum of their parts. And what we have here is a very simple small function that it's a higher order function. It takes another function and an argument and applies it twice. And what we can do is that if we invoke it with an int, then this will just be cascading code generation with with ints all the way down. And since we are lazy, we only generate code as it's needed. We will first generate twice with an int, and it will invoke it twice with an int argument, and then an inc with an int argument will be generated. We'll see that it returns double. But when the second one is invoked, then what will happen here is that we gradually have this optimism in the system where we say, okay, we pass double to twice, and so we'll pass it as a double to f, which is inc, but we can still optimistically presume that maybe it will return an int, maybe we'll be lucky. However, that increment function, it statically, we can prove that if it gets an int, gets a double, it will have to return a double. So the thing that you see up there, it cannot stand. So in the second step, what happens is that the compiler will have to say, well, you know what, I actually got back a double from the first invocation, but maybe if I feed it back into the function, maybe I will get back an int now. And so we feed it back. And it again returns a double. And now the return type of the whole expression becomes double, and the twice function itself becomes double. So what happens here is that we will just gradually be widening type. So even the return type for twice only gets widened to double if it ends up invoking a function that will return double to it. And this functional composition is we just make sure that the narrowest possible types are always propagated. And of course, the int versions of the functions are retained in parallel. So if you were to later again invoke this with ints, then the int versions get invoked. All right. How do we optimize running code? That's actually a little bit thorny, right? So if we, at any point in the execution of the code, we decide that something should be returning an int, but it did return a double, obviously a bytecode is invalid. We cannot really do that. So we need to be able to recompile it on the fly, which we do, which is less of a problem, but we also need to be able to replace running code on top of the stack. And we do that as well. The trick that we do for that is we actually do throw an exception at that point. We generate a one-time continuation version of the bytecode, which can be a little bit tricky if you're jumping in the middle of like several nested ifs and loops and whatnot, but we manage it. And then we just invoke that one-time continuation once. So that's a bunch of quite heavy lifting there. What I'm really proud of, that we actually solved this in a purely bytecode manner, purely in a, on a JVM spec level. So just a sec. So we don't actually use any JVM tricks. So Nashorn code as such, it runs on an IBM VM as well. Sorry, you had a question. Okay, the question is, do we save the continuation in the exception? No, the exception saves the state of the local variables. Okay. And the program pointer, where do you need to continue execution. And then that jumps back into the caller, and the caller's call site is linked in such a manner that it knows if it invoked a function that might be deoptimized. It has a try-catch, where the catch actually goes into the derails into the compiler to generate the new version of the function and the continuation, and then just do a, like a, the equivalent of a tail call into the continuation. All right. So I want to show you how various things in Nashorn actually affect performance. So let's write a small web application. Now we get to the integration part. There is a bunch of really good frameworks out there, Vertex. There's some kind of we also have Avatar.js, Red Hat has Nodeen, and so on. But you know, I'm an old guy, and I also like simple stuff, so I would just use Servlet API, which has been around since forever. Well, or rather, it's the only server-side API I know, because that was the only one last time I had to actually program a web application. And to minimize overhead, I also use Jetty as an embedded server. So I do actually have this thing here. I'm sorry, I cannot really make it much larger. So what I like about Jetty is that these lines of code is all that you need to actually start up a web server. And how readable is this? It is OK? Yeah, OK. All right. So and I wrote a crypto servlet base, which is just doing the usual stuff of like doing some kind of building a bit of a web page, and then invoking an actual evaluation of a result. It's running the crypto benchmark. So if you run this thing, then gives you a text box, and anything that you punch into the text box, it just goes over to the server. Oh, wow. apparently did something wrong. This is the demo gods are not with us today. Alert is not defined. All right. This is weird because I don't even have anything named alert anywhere. Yeah, but it's supposed to be server-side. OK. Demo gods have failed me. I did demonstrate the same thing, and I didn't touch the code twice so far. And now it's, anyway, let's not let this stop us. So the minimum thing that, so I'm using the Octane's crypto benchmark because it's a number crunching. There's no performance story in showing you how does it performs with Java databases or Java I/O, because that's just using Java libraries. It's as performant as Java, right? So that's why I was concentrating on number crunching. So the most naive approach that you can do is you can instantiate a new script engine on each request, and you can evaluate the JavaScript code in it on each request. And this would look something like this, where my evaluate function, which is invoked on every request, you would go, you would retrieve a new fresh engine, you would evaluate your script into it, you would pass it the variables that you extracted from the request, and then you would evaluate encryption, evaluate decryption, and return these back. Now, how does this perform? As it turns out, it performs epically poorly. So it's like the 50th percentile, and I was benchmarking this with Apache Bench, will give you like 2 seconds response time, and the longest request is more than 7 seconds. But obviously, yes, because you are bootstrapping a whole new Nashorn engine on each request, right? And evaluating everything into it. So don't do this. Obviously, why can you even do this, right? Well, here's why. JavaScript as a language, and most dynamic languages, don't have a concept of compilation or even runtime or anything. JavaScript's language specification just tells you, here's the source code, here's how you run it. It doesn't specify intermediate steps. You are free to implement this any way you want. So when you integrate with Java, you actually need to yourself figure out at what level do you want to cache things, how much work of going from source code to execution can you actually snapshot, and what needs to be repeated. And this is where the various possibilities come in. If you look into where does the time go, then you can see that most of the time is spent in one-time code setup, basically dynamic linking, so things that run here, aside from the first, which is JETI-IO wait, is call site relink internal, relinkable call site initialize, install class. So basically, Nashorn is parsing and generating code and linking it each and every time that you invoke a request. Obviously, this is a super slow way to do it, as witnessed. So how about we just use a single engine instance? If we rewrite our evaluate method so that it's only using a single static engine. Obviously, if you're in a servlet world, you would put it in a servlet context, but let's not complicate matters. Let's just pretend it's static now. And this time you have one engine, and on each request you are evaluating the script. And there's something above that, which is this bindings, create bindings, which bindings are actually a global scope for your variables. And you need to have a new one for each evaluation if your stuff is stateful. But we'll get to that as well, whether this is a necessary thing. So if we do that, what do we see? If I run Apache Bench with this guy now, single engine instance, we see that the execution time has went down dramatically. The worst case is still 3-second-ish, which is fine, which is bad, sorry. But 50th percentile is down to under 200 milliseconds, which already is tolerable, but of course we can do better. So this alone helped a lot. So Nashorn actually has code caching. So if I go back here, you can see that engine eval, every time you pass it a URL reader with a script URL. But Nashorn is actually clever enough to notice that you passed it a URL reader, it will extract the URL from it, see whether it already compiled that class, that script, and then it will not compile it again. You still have the overhead of opening a reader, though. Question, why don't we just have an API that where you pass a URL? Well, because JavaX script, script engine eval, does not have it. It only can take a string or a reader. Wasn't me. who designed that. So it can be helped further if you use the compilable and compiled script stuff from JavaScript API. And this is not Nashorn specific, actually. This is like probably applies to any dynamic language engine. Again, this is all JavaScript API stuff. You can actually cast your engine into compilable, which provides compilation services, and ask it to give you back a compiled script. So you say just compilable.compile, pass it the reader, and then instead of saying to engine to evaluate every time, you tell the compiled script to evaluate itself into a newly created script context. So if you do this, we actually get even a little bit more fast. So on the left is the old one, and on the right is the new one. The first is with the reader, the other is the compile script. We gain some 40-ish milliseconds on the 50th percentile, and actually even more further down the line. So crazily enough, even if you don't read the reader, just open it, you still manage to, it still adds almost 40 milliseconds, which is silly, but still. So the question is, are we evaluating everything? So there's always an eval. And if you look at into this crypto.js script that we are evaluating every time, it's actually, you know, there's 100-ish functions, and, you know, it's pretty large. So is all of that evaluated every time on every request? Well, here's the good news. No, it's not. Because when you have, say, this large function here, when you evaluate it, what happens is that the function body itself has been compiled once. And all that happens here is basically the equivalent of var whatever equals function. So we just take a pre-existing function object and we just assign it to a variable. That's what JavaScript does. So no matter how large is a function, on new execution, it will just be one single assignment of a pre-existing function object into a variable name. So that's a so code is compiled once, and then you are just populating the global scope with all the functions. That's fairly cheap to construct. Well, as you can see, 159 milliseconds get you encryption and decryption and full population of all the functions into a new scope. Yeah, I was telling you about this. I sometimes speak out of turn, so I have slides, but maybe I already explained this to you. So what I was saying about JavaScript not having a separation of compile and runtimes. So what happens if you use a single bindings object? Now let's just consider that we are not creating new bindings for every request, but we evaluate once, as this approach shows. We take the engine, we don't bother with compilable script because we'll just do it at once. We evaluate that script into the engine. The engine has a default set of global variables in it. And then we just go to the engine, we extract the references to the functions named encrypt and decrypt from them. We can do that because the functions are just first class objects in JavaScript and they are assigned to variables, so they will show up like that. And then our evaluation, the work that we do on every request is just those three lines in evaluate, where we call the encrypt function, call the decrypt function. By the way, here you can see how you can do this from Java. The JS object is the public interface that Nashorn exposes for JavaScript objects. And if those objects happen to be functions, then you can use the call method on them. The first null that's passed, that's the this, which doesn't matter. If you do this, we suddenly go, whoa, way down. Down to 35 milliseconds at the 15th percentile, so that's down from 150. We are shaving off serious time here, right? So this is getting much, much faster. You don't even have the overhead of initializing the global space with built-in JavaScript object plus everything that crypto defines. Yes, but is it thread safe? We'll get back to that. Obviously, it's not. And what happens if you turn optimism on? In Java 8.U.40, optimistic typing is off by default. So if you run it, you will have much wider types than you would otherwise need to be. If we turn optimism, then we will do this whole thing with type speculative code and then adaptively recompile it on the fly when needed. To turn it on, we now need to use Nashorn-specific API. So as you can see, I'm importing JDK Nashorn API, Nashorn Script Engine Factory, because it has a separate API called GetScriptEngine to which you can pass command line flags. And you can actually use this if you want to have a customized Nashorn engine with separate flags for any other command line flags as well, not just optimistic types. So if you do this, we actually get even faster, on the order of 2 to 3 times faster, because the crypto's hot methods, after we do this compilation, they pretty much look like they were compiled from Java code with static types. If I go here and I actually run crypto from command line, Yeah, well, it doesn't do anything, but I mean, it doesn't have an output. But if we print code, and I just hope that optimistic types are on by default, I think they are, then after a lot and a lot and a lot of code generation, we can try to find this hot function. Yeah, that will be the one. And as you can see, it's all just iloads, istores, all the way. So all primitive bitwise operations on everything. And if we scroll down to find local variable table, you can see that aside from this and the arrays, everything is int. So the code is actually as effective as if you just wrote the same algorithm, the same number crunching algorithm in JavaScript. So yeah, it's fast. It is slower to start up, though. 3 seconds got up to 4.7. Why? Well, because whenever a type assumption fails, we need to recompile code. So we have a lot of code generation churn as the engine starts up. In crypto, specifically, 35 functions are recompiled for a total of 67 times before it achieves a steady state. So why is optimistic slower to start? Here's another function, and like this dot array is first presumed to be an int, but it will turn out that it's not. This dot abs, the function calls, will be presumed that they return int, but they do not. They actually return a big integer object that the crypto defines, and so on and so on. We also benefit from compile runtime interleaving, though, with Nashorn, because our compiler kicks in while code is running. So we can actually inspect local variables. So for instance, r.array, the compiler is smart enough to evaluate all the side effect free expressions that are in the lexical scope and figure out that, hey, this guy is also an object. So I might emit code as if it were an int, but I just looked at him and I see that it's an object, so it will trigger the optimizing recompilation later on. I might as well just widen it now. This saves a lot of recompilation. So that's an actual benefit of not having a separation between compile and runtime, but rather having them interleaved, is that that you can use runtime information while you are compiling. So let's use a car analogy. Why not? It actually, this car analogy works terribly in the United States because they all drive automatics. So so in lower gears, it's always easier to start the car, but you cannot reach as good a speed, right? And in a higher gear, it's harder to start the car. I mean, if it's not a diesel, even second gear is problematic. But obviously, you can reach a much better top performance. So it's almost like Nashorn. Normal compilation is second gear. And I would wager to say optimistic typing is the third gear. First gear would be interpreter, which we don't have. And we also don't have a shifting mechanism. So right now, whatever you start with, it's the gear you're stuck with until the end of the execution. We are working on all of these things, but you know, small team, usual excuses. we are understaffed. So Nashorn also has this thing that's called type info cache, which you can turn on by specifying a system property with the maximum number of files it's allowed to cache in some sort of a operating system specific cache directory. It's off by default because we don't want to write files to your disk by default. But basically what it can do is it can write information about discovered types in functions to disk. So next time you start your VM, it actually compiles with this, the optimization point already. That cuts down on startup time. So if non-optimistic was starting up in 3 seconds and optimistic was starting at 4.7 seconds, if you turn on type caching, then your second startup for crypto at least goes down to like 3.5 seconds, which is still slower than the pessimistic one, but you know, it's a trade-off we need to live for now, and it's already faster than your top speed will already be faster than you have with pessimistic. So if you want to use optimistic and you are restarting your application frequently, then consider using type caching, because this will improve your your startup performance with optimistic types. Oh yeah, going back to thread safety. Well, no, it's not thread safe. I actually have a variant of the this little evaluation stuff that deliberately has shared mutable state, where instead of invoking the functions, I put new variables into the global scope and then pass them to functions with that, just to make it just to have shared mutable state and have it in a single bindings. And if I run side by side an Apache bench with two on two threads, if I do it with any other variant of the code, I will get zero non-200 responses because I coded the servlet so that it double checks whether when it does the encryption and the decryption, it gets the back the same plain text as it went in. So normally it works, but if I deliberately play the stupid programmer and make my code non-thread safe, and I run Apache Bench again, then, well, oops, what I get after running 1,000 requests, I will get about 12 race conditions. So obviously, this is the culprit, right? That I'm putting the data from different requests into the same engine global space. Now, let's go back to separate bindings, because obviously if you go back to separate bindings, what does the optimistic now do? Well, the optimistic, again, still shaves off time. So instead of 159 milliseconds, we would get 735. But remember, this was a beautiful 20 milliseconds or even less with single bindings. Of course, if you have shared mutable state, you can't have single binding. This is the cost of shared mutable state. So what I'm saying is, keep it immutable, right? If you can't, then use a single engine instance, but you will have to use separate bindings. Or you might resort to all kinds of other tricks. Nashorn has, we have all of our extensions to JavaScript are contained in a capital J Java object. And one of those is java.synchronized, which takes a JavaScript function and an object that you will lock on and returns you a version of that function that locks on, that's synchronized on that particular object that you passed in. Or you might be populating it with POJOs that you know are thread safe. So you can do manual synchronization from JavaScript if you want to. You might rewrite your logic in Java and make sure it's thread safe there. Or you can use separate bindings and take the performance hit for more costly initialization at every time. Or you know, you might just embrace 21st century programming best practices and just make sure that your data structures are immutable. And in that case, you can use single bindings, and in that case, you get back get down to the sweet 15 millisecond execution time. Single engine, use a single engine because code is always cached on an engine level, and we have hidden classes in the background. And when we link code, it does depend on the hidden classes. Hidden classes are basically a mapping from JavaScript property names to the generic fields in the Java classes that we use as containers. So using a single engine is always a good idea. You can have multiple bindings, and each multiple bindings will have their own definition of JavaScript top-level classes and so on, but you will always be sharing the code, and you will be sharing the JavaScript hidden classes. So, question?
Can we just use a singleton engine and get bindings that are thread local?
So the question is, can we use single engine and use bindings that are thread local? Yes, you can. That is a perfectly valid strategy if you are willing to do things like, you know, in a thread pooling environment and so on. Yeah, you can have thread local bindings. That would work. So as long as they are otherwise isolated from each other. But yeah, use a single engine and use different bindings on different threads. That includes making sure that they are sticking around in a thread local. Yeah, that works. So really quickly, structure of Nashorn object. Nashorn objects, and this is again performance, but from the other side, understanding a little bit the memory footprint of the whole thing. We will generate JavaScript's general purpose classes that have a number in their name. So JO2 will have two general purpose fields, and it will have a reference to an array, which might be null for all the dynamically for all the other properties it can dynamically acquire, and it has a pointer to the property map, which tells that the object that the property foo maps to O1, and the property color or whatever maps to O1 to the other field, because the fields are generically named. That's why we actually have a separate mapping to provide you with the actual JavaScript name to JavaScript field name. It also has a pointer to its prototype, and there is also a pointer to array data, because if you start filling up your object with properties that look like whose name look like their numbers, then we will treat those as array elements and pack them in there. When we use optimistic typing, then fields come in pairs. We will also have long fields next to each object field. This is because you can store a pointer and a primitive in the same field in Java, unfortunately or fortunately. So ints are not boxed into objects or longs and doubles, but we just take 64-bit primitive fields and we will map ints and longs and doubles into that. So when properties are allocated, these are the recommended patterns. So if you initialize an object literal and you list the values, or you have a constructor function that's assigning things to fields of this, or you have a scope, right? So in that last example, that's a little bit harder to notice, but actually A and B are parameters, but they are used by a nested function. Therefore, an implied scope object needs to be created that will be read. In this case, we will always be able to very efficiently figure out that, yes, we will allocate a Java object with two generic fields and map things into them. If you don't do that, but rather just allocate an object with curly braces and then just start throwing properties into it, then those will all go into that spill array, because lexically we cannot figure out how many properties to start with. But if you write code where the compiler can figure out how many properties you start with, then you are making the life much easier. Arrays are a little bit different. Arrays don't have any property fields, because we presume that, you know, most people don't add named properties to arrays. Of course, you're allowed to, because again, the language allows it. But those will all go into the spills. On the other hand, the array data pointer is another level of indirection to an actual primitive array. And in Nashorn, all arrays start as int arrays. So if you just pack ints into your arrays, then you're golden. The linkage for a call site that accesses it will be a very thin guard, where the fast path is actually dereferencing the array, dereferencing the object, dereferencing the array field, and then doing an immediate array element getter into data. And the hotspot can very beautifully inline it, so it's very fast. What I suggest, use homogeneous arrays. If you have an array and you pack million ints into it, and then you add a double, then we will, behind the curtains, we will take that int array data and we replace it with a double array, and we need to move everything in there widened into a double. If you add an object into your array, we will now need to go and box all those million doubles and turn everything into an object array. So it's a super good idea to try to get your arrays be of homogeneous type. And if you can make that type be int, then that's especially good. Avoiding differently typed sentinels. Sometimes you have these algorithms that like work on numbers and then just put an object at the end as kind of a sentinel. Just don't do that. Undefined is a special case, because we handle all undefined and deleted elements from arrays so that we keep the underlying representation and overlay it with a bit set that tells you which elements are undefined or deleted. So that's sort of safe, but yeah, I don't know. Don't count if it's still not good. What about none? None is a double value, and everything that comes with it. You put a none into it, it will explode into a double array. All right. Another piece of advice. If you want fast code, avoid evil. Evil is evil. That's the most concise way I can put it. Because to evil, you pass a string, which is a code to execute. And the compiler at this point, the compiler throws up its hands, says, we cannot prove anything. Evil can define new local variables within the function it is invoked. It can modify any of the local variables in that function or any in its lexical scope. It can reference the arguments object, which in JavaScript is an array-like object that represents all the parameters to the function. So if there's an evil, we have to presume that the function is variable arity. It's horrible. And a lot of those is true even if a nested function contains eval. Optimistic typing will still work, but we will but all the local variables will be just put into a scope object, into an implicit scope object, and we will be doing optimistic property getters, setters into it, and doing a lot of the compiling. So you don't lose types as such, but all the typing will be optimistic typing. Static type inference is completely turned off. With. With is maybe only half as evil as eval is. Still not, I would still not suggest using it because it does something very sinister that you don't really think about. It's so nice, right? You just say with and then you put there an object. People like to use it with Java package objects. With Java util, and then they can just say array list and whatnot. But it's bad because it creates, normally you have, JavaScript uses lexical scoping, right? But if you use with, you introduce dynamic scoping. That guy, that with statement, creates a fork in the scope lookup because any variable that you need to dereference, so for instance, x, we need to first look up whether z has a member named x, and if it doesn't, then we go back to lexical lookup. So x itself will not be able to, we will not be able to compile it into a JVM local variable. For the other guy, y, since it's not referenced from within the with block, we will actually be smart enough to keep it as a local variable, but not the other one. Final thing that you should sort of avoid doing is, here's how property getter works in Nashorn. So if you have this little program that defines an array with four literals, and you just go through it and you retrieve the member named A from each array element, first time you start this program, the whatever implements the dot A logic will actually just be pointing back to our dynamic linker. First time the array executes, we will actually link it so that, well, if whatever we resolved as array J returns the whatever is the hidden map for the first object, then just return the field 0. Otherwise, well, again, go to the relinking. And then on the next one, you will have another cascade where it will say, well, if it's the second one, then return the field J1, because it probably will end up in J1 since I defined it as first B, then A. Otherwise, if it's the previous kind of object, then return JO. Otherwise, relink. And this, you know, you see where it goes. However, you quickly get, this is typically what's referred to as polymorphic call site, right? And they're great to avoid. Nashorn actually will allow you a cascade of 8 different hidden classes at this call site. And after that, it just throws up its hands and says, OK, we'll switch to megamorphic lookup, where on each invocation, it will do a slow lookup for a member. And how dramatic is that? Well, this dramatic. If you have, here's a code. And I just did the same thing. So here's several objects. They all have an A, but they have a different second named property. So they will be different hidden classes. And we go around it 10 million times. Yeah, 10 million times we go through the array. And let's see. Time. Yes. This takes not that long to run, actually, surprisingly. It's like 1.9 seconds. OK. Now, but this is only 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 different hidden classes. If you add the ninth one, which is the point where Nashorn gives up, then it's somewhat slower. It should come out at around 8-ish seconds, hopefully. Yep. So that's the difference. If you want to find megamorphic call sites, if you want to know whether you are subjected to megamorphic call sets, you can run Nashorn with logger for fields. And here it actually gave you a diagnostic message, which could be improved with an actual line number. But the point is that you can actually figure out whether you suffer from megamorphic call sites or not, because that's something that we try actively to avoid. So there's a logger for that. So these are the things. It matters how do you integrate your code into Nashorn. It matters that you don't write clever code that's too clever for the compiler to figure out. And If it's still slow, then you can rightfully blame us, because at that point you did everything right, and everything that's left was is Nashorn team's fault. All right, that's all I had. Thank you very much. Okay, I think we have a little bit of time for questions.
Right. You're planning to implement ECMAScript 6?
Okay, the question is, sorry, again?
If you're planning to implement ECMAScript 6.
Oh, okay,
6.
The question is, do we plan to add ECMAScript 6 support? Yes, as a matter of fact, it is already a little bit in there, so I could use a const here if I wanted to, and if I ran this guy, it would complain that something is not okay, but it actually runs if I tell it to use language equals ES6. It's partial support. We support const and let at the moment. We don't support much of anything else, but you know, it's a work in progress. Again, we are a small team. We have to figure out what features to add, but we are gradually and admittedly slowly adding ECMAScript 6 features piecemeal. Yep.
So my question is, the startup is the hardest part here. So
yes.
What do you do to make it start faster? Okay, what's the basic strategy here?
All right, the question is, the startup is the hardest part, and what do we do in order to make it better? Well, we did a lot of extensive benchmarking of this whole thing and figured out that by now, most of our startup overhead is when we send the compiled class to be installed by the JVM. So JVM installation and linking and eventual JIT compilation seem to be the overhead, which leads to a very uncomfortable answer that the only way to make this better is for Nashorn to gain an explicit interpreter stage, which we might or might not be working on.
This stage is only applicable to Nashorn or maybe for other dynamic
OK, follow-on question. Would this interpreter stage only be applicable to Nashorn or also other dynamic languages? Currently, Nashorn only, because an interpreter, in order for us to implement it right now, our intermediate representation is JavaScript abstract syntax tree. We would need another kind of intermediate representation, something like a bytecode for dynamic languages, in order for this to be generally usable. But we don't have that yet.
Is there a movement?
I mean, is there a... Yes. I specifically would love to work on that. So I talked about it at the JVM Language Summit last year. The question is there a movement to provide this kind of a dynamic bytecode on the JVM? Yes, there is, in a sense that I intend to do it whenever I get time. I would really love to do it. And so it's on my list, because my agenda at Oracle is promoting support for dynamic languages on the JVM in general. Nashorn, to me, is a means to an end, basically a way to come up with these solutions and then later figure out how to generalize them. So yeah, I would love to move into that direction, but that's a long-term goal. All right, we had a question back there.
Yeah, my question is related to the last one. What's the difference between compiling a dynamic language and a static language?
Okay,
what's the difference? For example, just to follow up, yeah. Many people say that many people think that static languages are by definition faster, for example, mm-hmm. And is that so?
Okay. So the question is whether what's the difference between compiling a static and dynamic language, and the second part was about whether static languages are faster than dynamic languages.
Are they somewhat inherently faster?
Oh yeah, I see.
Or is it theoretically possible to be
They're not inherently faster, as I said already with the crypto benchmark here. We did prove to ourselves that we can emit code that's as efficient JavaScript code as if it were written in Java. All the types are ints. It is really just as efficient as an equivalent code algorithm coded in Java. The biggest difference between compiling dynamic and static is that if a static static compiler, if it cannot prove the type of an expression at compile time, it will throw a compile time error and tell you, dear programmer, to man up and figure out what type did you have in mind here. While in a dynamic language, it is not an error for a type to be undecided at compile time, so we need to do all this smartness about presuming the best that it will be an int, and then gradually de-optimizing at runtime if it turns out that, no, it's not an int, now it's a double. Oh, wait, it was a double, but now it's a string. Oh, wait, it was a string, but now it's an array. So that's the basic difference, is that a static compiler will just throw an error if it cannot decide a type. We, on the other hand, will have to emit code and have runtime infrastructure for speculative typing.
OK, thanks very much.
All right, we have a question there.
Are you currently building this as part of a Jigsaw module?
Are we currently building this?
Do you have a Jigsaw module for Nashorn?
Probably. I am a terrible person to ask about that, because I'm trying to be independent of the whole module story as long as I can. We have a colleague that's working on making sure that Nashorn works in modularized world. So yeah, eventually Nashorn will, in Java 9, it will live as a module, just as does everything else. But right now, it's weird, but from my point of view, who just write the code and commit it to OpenJDK, the way whether it's built and declared the module, it doesn't really affect me. So as strange as it sounds, I don't know. You get a mic. It's better that way because it's recorded.
A lot of the advice you gave for optimizing JavaScript is generally usable for JavaScript, not only for the Nashorn implementation, but also for the C implementations like V8. And it's exactly the same things. Don't use eval, don't use with. When you have object literals, order the properties in the same order. Declare your properties at the earliest stage, so the compiler knows how many slots to give to the object. Have you done something with the JavaScript community about this? So it's generally usable advice. It's not only for Nashorn, but for JavaScript everywhere.
Well, here's the thing. I don't dare to imagine whether all of this advice actually applies to all other runtimes or not. Some of this advice applies if your underlying runtime is smart enough to actually take advantage of this information. So you could have a less sophisticated JavaScript runtime, which, for instance, does not know to allocate, doesn't care to allocate a set number of properties up front. V8 does. So V8, I dare to say V8 right now is still more sophisticated than we are, and probably will stay this way for quite a long time. There's a lot of very smart people working at Google on V8, and it's a really great engine. But for instance, WID is an interesting thing, because actually with some particularly smart use of partial evaluation at runtime, you could even get into a situation where you could eliminate most of the overhead with WID. At least I believe that that's the case. So that's why I'm dispensing this as Nashorn specific advice, because I know that Nashorn can be tripped by these and Nashorn can be helped by these. And you know, since most of the JavaScript runtimes have to follow more or less the same techniques for implementing things during this sort of like common origin, it will probably apply to other runtimes as well. But I'm not really, and they sound commonsensical. Evil definitely, because you can't do much with that. But I don't try to structure this as here's an advice and it works for every JavaScript runtime. I just don't have enough knowledge about them to say that.
The truth is, no one has that much knowledge. However, it's still generally applicable.
Yes, it is. Okay, I agree. Further question with this? Okay. All right. Okay. Well, thank you. I think we're. Thank you.